Hello and welcome to another episode of the Agency Leadership Podcast. I'm Chip Griffin.
And I'm Gini Dietrich.
And today, we're not going to depress you, but we might recess you right after this.
Boy, I missed your segues. That was special.
Did you have a good vacation?
I did. Thank you.
I'm glad to hear that. It's important to take time off. But that's not what we're talking about today. We're talking about something much more stressful and, yes, probably a little bit depressing for some of you to think about. But I've been asked, and I know you've been asked, Jenny, so many times by agency owners in recent weeks about the possibility of a recession, the R word. People are, some people are freaking out. Some people are just wondering about it. Is it going to happen? What should we be doing? And so we've talked about having this as a topic now for the last month or so. We kept putting it off, and I don't think we can do that any longer because the curiosity and concern is rising to a level that we just can't ignore it anymore.
Yeah, I think the Jamie Dimon doing the rounds calling it an economic hurricane probably did not help matters, because I have a friend who called me and was like, "What does this mean?" And I was like, "It's okay. It's okay. Wait, it's cyclical. It's our turn. It's okay. We all survive. It will be okay."
Right. Well, I think that's the thing. I mean, from the outset, you have to enter this with the idea that whatever happens, you're going to make your way through it. Particularly if you've been around for the last couple of years as an agency and you're still around.
Right? And you're still around, you will be fine.
You're going to be fine. You know that you can take even the most outlandish of setbacks and power through them. And so if you start with that mindset, it helps a lot. But there are things that you can and should do to make yourself more resilient in the event of a recession. And neither you nor I are an economist. And as I said in a recent piece, I didn't stay in a Holiday Inn Express last night. So I am no expert on the economy or anything like that. But you see enough news stories that you start to say, well, you know, maybe there's something to this. But there are things you can do to better prepare yourself. But those are things that would help you no matter what. So whether there's a recession or not, these things are going to help you, and they're things you ought to be doing anyway.
Yeah, for sure. And you're right. You should be doing this stuff anyway. And some of the things that you noted in your article are things like keeping 3 months of cash. You should do that anyway. You know, one of the things that I always do is make sure that credit cards and any outstanding debt on my line of credit is paid down or off, paid off entirely. If you don't have a line of credit, now is a good time to do that, because the banks are going to be more willing to give you money now before everything falls apart than they will be when everything falls apart. So there are things that you can be thinking about, especially from a cash perspective. And remember, the phrase, the cash is king, exists for a reason. Cash is king. So have as much cash in the business as you can have, as you possibly can keep. 6 months is better than 3 months. 3 months is better than nothing. And really work toward finding ways for you to alleviate your cash crunches while you're waiting to be paid by clients.
Well, and that's really key. I mean, that having cash or having anything that gives you flexibility is important, and cash gives you that flexibility so that you can make more intelligent decisions. You don't have to make rash, sudden decisions because you're concerned about meeting payroll next week, right? And so the idea is that at all times within the agency, but particularly when there's the potential for an economic downturn, you want to be able to think things through clearly and have an orderly transition plan to whatever that next stage is. And cash is one of the things that helps you get there.
Yeah. And I think also, you know, continuing to demonstrate the value of the work that you do. You know, I think this is really hard for especially communications, PR professionals. It's really hard for that type of agency because so much of the work that we do is built on brand awareness. And, you know, clients, we're always the first to go. And I think you mentioned this in your article as well, that RGA just laid off a bunch of people because they're reading the tea leaves as well. Our industry, marketing, digital marketing, web, PR, whatever it happens to be, it's a big budget line item on the P&L, and it's easy for a CFO to go and just cut it off. So protect yourself. Protect yourself with things in your contract that don't allow them to email you today and fire you by the end of day. Like, you should have you should have clauses in there that are 30, 60 or 90 day termination clauses. You should have, you should be being paid upfront 30 days in advance, at least, so that when these things happen, you're not caught with, you know, sort of holding the bill in your hand. So there are lots of things that you can do to prepare for downturns from this perspective.
Absolutely. And how vulnerable you are depends in large part on the kinds of services that you're providing. Because sure, as you mentioned, you know, if you're providing traditional media relations, you tend to be on the chopping block a lot faster unless you're doing crisis comms, because those are the kinds of things that it's harder for executives to understand and apply a tangible value to, which is why you need to be consistently reporting it at all times. But certainly anytime you see the handwriting on the wall, that budgets may be getting a closer review. The closer your work is, though, to direct revenue generation. So if you're an agency providing e-commerce services, you know, managing someone's Shopify platform, driving direct sales leads through advertising to a store or something like that, those are the things that are going to be a little bit more resilient typically, because everybody's trying to figure out, how do I preserve my own revenue? So you need to understand what's specific to your agency, the services that you're providing, and also the people that you provide them to, right? Some sectors are going to do better or worse depending upon what happens.
Absolutely.
And so to assume here that all agencies are going to be equal in a recession, we know that's not true. You and I have been around the block a few times. We've seen a few of these things, and it is not at all equal. Even 2 years ago, when everything shut down, not all agencies felt the pain in the same way. In fact, some thrived because of the switch from brick and mortar to digital and things like that. So you need to really have your ear to the ground and understand what's going on with your clients, with the industries that you serve and the services you provide.
Yeah. And then I would say, really look at your staffing. You know, one of the things that I say, that I repeat over and over and over again, is having a nice mix. And we've talked about this too. Like, can we build $1 million agency with just contractors? Should we have a mix? Should we only have employees? And I think and we did an episode on this recently, but I think having a nice mix of employees plus contractors gives you the ability to scale up and scale down. And the very first thing you can do is, and unfortunately as a contractor, you're the first to go in these situations, because it allows you that flexibility to scale down when you lose a client or two or 10 because of the economy.
Right. And that elasticity helps you, and it helps you at all times. Again, as we've talked about, it helps you during the growth times, and it helps you during the belt tightening times as well. And so you want to build that into your model overall. And it's that mixture of making sure you have the right agreements with contractors and vendors, with having that cash reserve, with having the right mindset. All of these things give you that runway to make smart decisions.
One of the things that you don't have in your article, but we have talked about, is having more than one revenue source. And I, you know, that's the biggest lesson I learned during the Great Recession was we lost 90% of our clients and there was no revenue. That was it. Like just fee. We're selling our time for fee, and that was it. So I really looked at it and I thought, okay, how do I build this business so that we have multiple revenue sources, so that when this happens again, if we lose 90% of our clients, and it happened in 2020, we lose 90% of our clients, we still have other revenue sources that will help us keep us afloat. Now, we certainly weren't in 2020, didn't do what we did in 2019 from a revenue standpoint, but it also didn't crush us because we had all the different revenue sources.
Right, and I think having revenue diversity in a lot of different ways is useful. So different offerings that you might have. Certainly, you want to avoid the whale clients that weigh you down, and that you're more likely to overservice and make bad decisions, or have to make really horrible decisions if they go away, right? So make sure that you've got diversity in all sorts of different ways in your revenue streams, and that will help you to be resilient, flexible, and elastic.
And then the last thing that I thought was really interesting that you brought up in your article is just communicate, you know, have honest and open conversations, not just with clients, but with prospects and with your team, to say, hey, listen, we're all reading the same news. We all think this is going to hit. We don't know what it's going to look like. We just came through the pandemic. We don't know. So let's be as open and honest as we can be. Let's find different ways to work things out. I mean, I'm having a conversation with a client right now about how to create different scenarios, you know, for plans A, B, C, D, and E and F in case something does happen. What does that look like? And what are the triggers for those plans?
Yeah, it's absolutely essential that you over-communicate with your team right now, because they are absolutely seeing these same things and they are worried, they are concerned. And for you to sort of say, well, you know, it's all fine for us, so I'm not going to say anything right now. I don't want to jinx it, or, you know, why even put this on their radar screen? It's on their radar screen.
Yes, it is.
And so it is better to be honest with them. And that's true even if things start to look worse for either the economy or for your agency in particular. Communicate with them about what it looks like, because they're going to notice. If you start having clients cutting back or canceling, they're going to see that happen. Don't just, you know, say, well, I don't really want to talk about this, right? It's not comfortable, but you need to, because they will almost always assume things are worse than they really are. So don't let them go there.
Yes.
Fill that vacuum with information so that they don't fill it with speculation.
This is a total aside, but it reminds me of the time that my business coach said to me, so why do you close your door during the day? And I was like, what do you mean? And he said, like, during the day, you get up and you close your door for several hours of time. And I said, yeah, so I can get work done uninterrupted. And he said, okay, but do you know what that's doing to your team? And I was like, no. And he said, they're freaking out. They think you're on the phone creating plans to fire them. And I was like, I'm just working. But that's what they do. So that proves your point that people, they do make it much worse in their heads than it actually is. So if you're communicating and you're communicating openly and you're saying, listen, Jamie Dimon just called this an economic hurricane. I don't know what to expect. Right now we're okay, but here are the things that we've done to prepare for it. Here are the things that we do all the time regardless. And let's work together to figure out, you know, if we lose one client, what does that look like? If we lose three clients, what does that look like? Let's work together to do that.
Right. Well, and that tangent that you went down, I will share that I had similar feedback over the years. So what I actually started doing was I closed my door for every single meeting. And I made a big deal about the fact that I closed the door for every single meeting.
For every meeting, yeah.
Because that way nobody could ever tell when I was having a true closed door meeting.
Right.
Versus when, I mean, because if someone just came into chit chat, I'd be like, close the door. And they'd be like, and so it just became,
smart.
That was
smart.
My natural yeah. habit. And so, so when I did need to have a true closed door conversation, either with them
nobody
or a phone call, nobody thought anything, because it's just this weirdo. He closes the door all the time and, you know, whatever. Right. So
I literally was like, I'm just working.
Right. And so, but you have to be aware of those things
right.
and find ways, you know, whether it's by keeping the door open all the time or by closing the door all the time or whatever, find those things that help communicate effectively to your team to alleviate their concerns as much as possible. And if they should be concerned, frankly, start telegraphing that. Right. If you think
right.
that you're at a place where you might have to be making some cuts in a month, start telegraphing it. Don't let the first time that they have any inkling that there's a problem be when they walk into your office and you say, bye-bye.
Yeah,
right?
I learned that lesson. You can't do that. Yep.
You have to, if things are going bad, let them know. Telegraph that we're looking at it. We're trying to figure out how to get through it. But there are going to be some tough decisions to be made because, again, you know, nobody likes surprises, right? People don't like good surprises. They don't like bad surprises.
That's
most
right.
people want to know what to expect. And so if you can drop hints and communicate with them in such a way that they can see the big picture before action is taken, you will generally get a better response when the time comes.
Absolutely. And I learned that lesson really the hard way, because during the Great Recession, to be perfectly frank, I was completely blindsided. I mean, I was reading everything and the economists were saying all this stuff, but I was so inexperienced and naive that I didn't understand what was actually coming for us and I wasn't prepared. And so we lost, like I said, 90% of our clients between December 22nd and January 2nd of 2008, 2009. I mean, lost them all. And so on January 3rd, I had to go back into the office, you know, after everybody came back from the holidays and I had to let everyone go. And I remember somebody saying to me, and it really hurt my feelings at the time, but I remember she said to me, why didn't you ask us for help? We would have helped. And I was like, I didn't know. Like, I didn't know. So please listen to us and ask your team for help.
Right. And I think, you know, just because we're telling you that you need to be paying attention to this, you need to be making plans and being flexible and all that kind of stuff, it doesn't mean that you should be paralyzed by fear of what's potentially coming. We don't even know what's coming, right? So, I mean, at some point, the economy will turn down, whether that is, you know, next week or next year or in 5 years, who knows?
Right.
And we've said this before. We've had a recession episode, even pre-pandemic, where we talked about some of these things. But, you know, one of the things that you need to make sure is that you're continuing to make the right decisions based on the best information that you have available. So don't sit here and say, I'm just going to freeze hiring because something might happen, right? You still need to run your business intelligently. And so should you be a little bit more cautious? Perhaps. Should you at least be thinking about, okay, what's the next step? If I do make this investment in a team member or a project, you know, what happens if I do have to pull back in 3 months? Do I have a course of action or if I boxed myself in? So think about those things, but don't act in that way where you start making bad decisions because you're concerned something else might, you know, another shoe might drop.
Absolutely. Yeah. You just be prepared.
Right. Because that's also where you start over-servicing clients.
Yeah.
Right? Bad all the time.
Bad
but it's
idea.
Something that when you start getting worried about revenue, what do? You over-service. What does that do? It makes it much worse.
You will not
help yourself by over-servicing a client to keep them. No. So stop it. Don't think that way. And also, by the way, if your agency is continuing to do well and the economy has a downturn and you're still doing well, that may actually be an opportunity for you, right? So particularly because we'll see a lot of some of the higher flying agencies, shall we say, not always large, but, you know, just the ones who have been very aggressive in some of the moves they've made in recent years may find themselves in a position where they have to let some real talent go if the economy turns down. If you're running things well and you've got things still firing on all cylinders, you can start picking up some real good talent on the market if you are smart and you're having that flexibility built into your plan.
It's kind of like buying stocks when the market crashes because you have the flexibility to be able to do that. So yeah, absolutely. You should be doing that, looking for that because, you know, if the economy tanks and like you said, it might be tomorrow, it might be 5 years from now, it will, there will be layoffs. And when that happens, if you're ready and you're prepared and you should be prepared regardless of how the economy is, you should be prepared. Having cash, having access to a line of credit so you have some flexibility, using contractors for the work that you wouldn't normally do, having open, honest conversations with clients, with prospects, with employees, all of that stuff is going to help you be prepared. Make sure that your contracts are solid so that they can't call you today and you're gone by tomorrow. Like there has to be some room in there for them to give and for you to give. So do those things and you will be prepared for whatever comes at you.
Absolutely. And I do want to throw one caution out there because you've mentioned line of credit a couple of times and you and I both agree lines of credit can be very helpful. They can also be insanely damaging if you don't know what you're doing.
If you don't know yet.
So I strongly encourage you, if you have a line of credit that is for short-term cash flow deviations, it is not for investing in the business. It's not for putting off tough decisions about reducing the size of your staff or reducing other expenses, right? It's literally short term. It's this client is just a little bit slow to pay and we need to bridge that gap. That's what you use the line of credit for.
Yep.
I've seen way too many agencies who think I'll get a line of credit and I'll use it to invest in the growth of the agency. I'm going to hire this person because I know that if I've got them, I can generate business. Don't do that. That is not, you should not be using debt. You should not be using equity to grow your agency. Grow organically and you will have a much more solid footing. In fact, you will see if the economy turns down in the early months, it will be the agencies that are relying on debt and equity that will have to make the biggest cuts the soonest. Don't be one of them.
Yep. Learn that lesson the hard way too. So don't be me.
Excellent. Well, on that note, we're gonna wrap up this not depressing, not recessing, but hopefully informative episode of the Agency Leadership Podcast. I'm Chip Griffin.
I'm Jenny Dietrich.
And it depends.